وله ومن آياته أن خلقكم من تراب ثم إذا أنتم بشر تنتشرون. ومن آياته أن خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. ومن آياته خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف ألسنتكم وألوانكم، إن في ذلك لآيات للعالمين. ومن آياته منامكم بالليل والنهار وابتغاؤكم من فضله، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يسمعون. ومن آياته يريكم البرق خوفا وطمعا وينزل من السماء ماء فيحيي به الأرض بعد موتها، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يعقلون. ومن آياته أن تقوم السماء والأرض بأمره، ثم إذا دعاكم دعوة من الأرض إذا أنتم تخرجون. وله من في السماوات والأرض كل له قانتون. وهو الذي يبدأ الخلق ثم يعيده وهو أهون عليه، وله المثل الأعلى في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم.
الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم إلى يوم الدين. سورة الروم was revealed in Mecca, and the theme of the surah is that the signs of Allah are so clear to demonstrate His lordship and his full control over the universe and everything that happened on it. So the signs identified in this surah are related to many areas, related to the universe, related to the human development, and related to the history in the surah. So these signs should actually, when you read it, reflect on it, it should reinforce the faith of the believer and frankly eliminate any excuse for those people who disbelieve or atheist or so. However, to truly appreciate the signs of Allah in the surah, this is an interesting part, one needs actually to have knowledge of many natural and social sciences to appreciate this. And this will be, you know, you probably people who can reflect on this deeply and understand what Allah is saying, people who study astronomy, meteorology, geology, geography, psychology, sociology, anthropology, and historiography. So there's so many topics. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanAllah gave me the Quran, as I said, the verses that relate to Allah, the particle of belief and the commands of Allah is probably less than 200 verses. The rest of the verses is supposed to expand the human, the reader mind or the Muslim mind, that he can appreciate really who is Allah through the knowledge of all of the different things. And we talked about this before. You noted in this surah, there is the phrase that came, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ and among his sign. This phrase came in the Quran 11 times. It came in this surah 7 times. that tell you the emphasis. That's why I said the theme of it is related to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these ayat is the ones that you listen to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about so many signs. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. Talk about the creation. Among his signs that he created you from dust, and then behold, you are human being scattered. And you look to all your body content, it is actually from dust. When we die, everything go back to where we came from. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Having the mates and the wife from yourself in order to have tranquility and contentment with each other. You know, that issue of love between the husband and wife, it's really amazing. You know, as I said before, if you think about it, you cannot change. If you hate somebody, there is no way you can yourself be able to love him, no matter how much people pay you to do it. Or if you love somebody, let you, you know, hate him. The desire of love and hate, it's something comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why I remember I give one time a talk about what is the most important materialistic blessing that Allah will ever give you. I don't know how many of you remember what was the blessing. Okay. What is it? Say it, Babar. What was
love?
Yeah, the love of people for you. Because there is no way Allah will love you and will make people hate you. So the love of people directly indicate the love, and you all know the hadith about that. When Allah loves somebody based on what he does, then he said, Jibreel, love him, and Jibreel asked the angel to love him, and then he will put the love of him in the heart of people on earth. So in that regard, that will be the one will achieve everything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this, you know, tranquility and contentment with each other, with the person, the wife and the husband. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this, when, you know, notice Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna fi thalika la ayatin liqawmin yatafakkarun. People who reflect on this and understand this sign are the people who have thinking. People who think, don't look at it and, you know, and pass by these signs without any reflection. And then go, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ آيَاتٍ لِلْعَالِمِينَ. Here is another sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that we're all created from one man and one woman. Why we look different? Why you speak different language? But these are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how we make you different in your language and in your colors. Although you came started from two, the same two. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this indeed is sign for those al-alimin who have knowledge. So it's an interesting, if you look to say somebody alim, we always think he's alim fi deen. But look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, who is alim? It's alim who understand the human being. How Allah subhanahu wa created them this way. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ مَنَامُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَرِ. Another sign of Allah sleep by night and by day. And you're seeking of his bounty, and by day, and you're seeking for his bounty. Verily, that's a sign for those people who listen. And فِي ذَلِكَ لَا تَنْقَوْمٍ يَسْمَعُونَ. If you ever feel that you want to sleep because there is more important meeting happening tomorrow, and you cannot sleep, you know, you will really be so, you know, anxious to sleep. Who make us sleep, frankly? You know, you lay in the bed, but why suddenly you go to sleep? And this also suddenly when you need some to do something, you wake up without any somebody pushing you or anything. You know, and you know, there is people who have this problem with sleeping. They take medication and so on. And you know Michael Jackson, why? Well, Michael Jackson was died because he was taking sleeping pills. You know, he was in injection actually. So sleeping is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we just overlook. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say it is his sign for you that you sleep. You know. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ يُرِيكُمُ الْبَرْقَ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَيُنْزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. This is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to people now who can study the movement. How the rain comes, what is this, you know, thunder and storms and so on. And if, among his sign, he shows you, among his sign that he shows you how, you know, the lighting, how it creates, you know, fear and hope. And he sends down water from the sky and he revives earth that us is dead. And then Allah subhanahu, indeed, in that there is a sign for those people who يعقلوا, those people who have brain, who can understand. ومن آياته أن تقوم السماء والأرض بأمره. And from his signs that the heavens and the earth stand by his command. And we looked at the earth and how the earth moves a million of miles per hour, and we're sitting stable on it, and we see the sky above us. Who control all of this? It's a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everybody study this. They know that if the speed of the earth changes but very small amount, none of us will exist. If the speed, you know, the reason why when you drive like 100 miles per hour, for example, and you cannot, I can get this cup here, I'm actually moving at million of miles per hour right now, but I can hold the cup and drink from it, it doesn't spill. You can hold this in the car and drive 100 miles an hour, spill over you, you know, why? Because the speed, if any time, if you change the speed, that's when everything goes away. The speed have to be so exact. Otherwise, we will never be, we'll be able to stand on earth. So, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, he's the one giving this. And then Allah says, إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ دَعْوَةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ إِذَا أَنْتُمْ تُخْرَجُونَ. And in the end of the day, you will go back to earth and die. And when he call you, you will come out of the earth again. And then ومن آياته أن يرسل الرياح مبشرات. And when his sign that he sent the winds was glad tidings, giving a taste of his mercy. And then without the wind, no ships will even go in the oceans. And then ولتجري الفلك بأمره. And then all of the ships sail by his command, and that you may seek of his bounty in order that you may be thankful. ولعلكم تشكرون. So, you notice something. What is all of these ayat? Where do you find it? Do you find these ayat, pictures of it in the Quran? No, it is outside. And this is why, you know, these, the revelation of Allah in the Quran, which people say it is a recited book, you know, that you read, the reading book, leads you directly to another revelation, to know Allah. And this is the what we call it, the seeing or the observed or perspective book. So the revelation, this universe, ourself, is actually a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you are going to contemplate and study the written book, the recited book, you should study also the seeing and the observed book. That's the only way to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's two books. We don't have only one book. Trouble with it, we pick one, and this one lead us to this, but we ignore this. Not you, but I mean, well, frankly, Muslim ignore this, because if we didn't ignore this, the Muslim situation wouldn't be the situation we have today. It's the most backward nations. You know, everything we use, somebody else make it. You know. So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep asking you, go look, study. If we would have studied the universe, if we have studied, we could have developed, you know, the cellular phone, we could have developed, people went to the moon, people have developed all of means of communication, you know, but we didn't. We just are a bunch of users of it, you know. And when I'm saying we, I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about, you know, a Muslim as a group, because as a ummah, you know, not as an individual. Yes, individually might be very, very successful, but Islam will never be built on an individual. It has to be a collective, because they all, you know, support each other and do it. So, and frankly, the only way somebody tell me I really know Allah, there is no way he will know Allah by reading the Quran. No way. It's an abstract. Allah in the Quran is an abstract concept. Allah in the universe is a real concept, because you know when you say Allah, you know Al-Alim, the one who controls everything. If you know that this earth will never survive, if just a minor change in speed, you know, happen, then in that case you said Subhanallah, who control it? Now you know who is Allah. Then Allah Subhanahu also gave us another example about you, and this is what I said. You know, the Allah recited book. the Quran leads you actually to the visual book, and here is the Quran and some pictures, you know, that shows where should we do. The only way is to understand it, to do this. Another one that Allah subhanahu gave us also as a sign of His is this development, our own development, and the phases we go in. Allah subhanahu الذي خلقكم من ضعف. You were a child, an infant, very weak. You need, you know, family to support you. ثم جعل من بعد ضعف قوة. الحمد لله, you grow up and become strong. And then after this, you become then, بعد القوة, after this strength, then you become weak again. And شيبة, and you have gray hair. This is a cycle that every human being, and Allah سبحانه يخلق ما يشاء وهو العليم القدير, and He is the one all-knowing, all-powerful. So this is a cycle every human being and Allah created this way. Allah also give us also a sign of the history that we should reflect on to understand Allah's divine rules. And this history comes in from knowing basically the fall and rise of civilization. Why civilization rise and fall? Why Muslim civilization was rising and now became, you know, is gone away? Why? Allah subhanahu says, ظهر الفساد في الأرض. Why is this? Because it's you did it. You know, it's your hand is the one did it. Not Allah, we cannot blame Allah. Allah, you are the one, you know. If you have willed us to be powerful, we would, no, you might, no. That is your problem. And Allah subhanahu says, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. That, you know, the corruption has spread on the land and the sea. Why? By the outcome of what the hand of people have earned. And Allah subhanahu says, لِيُزِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. He make it this way, make you something wrong happen to you so you can taste part of what will you have done. So you might come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and straighten your lives. Unfortunately, Muslim has been for hundreds of years now, they still feel it, but nobody wants to go back to straighten his life. And then Allah subhanahu, فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةً. قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Here is سيروا في الأرض. What? سيروا في الأرض reading the book? Or سيروا في الأرض do anthropology and study the history and look for things that happened in the past. سيروا في الأرض فانظروا كيف كان عاقبة الذين من قبل كان أكثرهم مشركين. That say, travel in the land and see what happened to the end of those people who were before you. Most of them was idolatorship. You know, sometimes we think always shirk that we are going to, people will worship idols. But that's not the only shirk. You know, shirk can be anything that you basically decide, my system is better than the system of Allah. The things that what Allah created me, I can do better. I don't like it. And this is why Allah subhanahu said, I created you in a pure nature. You know, in your disposition, your natural disposition is pure. You are the one who corrupted it. If all the commands of the religion is basically in harmony with the pure nature that you have. So all what you do, go to your own pure nature, what you call it, fitra. Allah created you with this. Every human being from, he understand that cheating is bad, truthfulness is good, generosity is good, misery is bad, you know, adultery is bad, stealing is bad. Everybody knew it, how in every society, in every community, no matter where you are, even the people who have never have any knowledge or any even, you know, civilization came to them, they know all of these principles. Why? Because it is a fitra. It's the natural instinct that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why there is no command you ever find it in the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you say, oh, it doesn't make sense. Logically, there is no way Allah created for us the brain, and the brain is consistent to accept what is in our pure nature. So anybody feel there is, oh, this command is unjust, you know, then there's two things happen. You either you are a selfish person because you want it's unjust to you because you want to acquire things that doesn't belong to you, or you did not understand the command. But any person with pure nature will have to will know directly that the commands of Allah are consistent with his pure nature, with his logic. There is no way anybody can object to this. And this is why Allah gave this, I consider, you know, a key verse to understand. If anybody tell you about anything in the religion, frankly, go back to your fitrah, your own pure nature. And I'm sure you will recognize if this, what he's telling you, is correct or not. Allah says, فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. Stand up steadily toward the religion. Here is a word that وَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ, stand your face, your purpose, should be steadily toward the deen, the religion, حَنِيفًا. You know, what does حَنِيفًا means? حَنِيفًا means actually to have deviation. It doesn't mean straight. But because the deviation is so widespread, you have to deviate from the deviation. You know, so the why, because it's always exist. How you can find a way out of all of this? That's why the proper translation, the way it did it, turning away from all that is false. So you basically, hanifan means deviating from the false. Yeah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fitrat Allah, this is according to the natural disposition that Allah have instilled in you. Lati fatara an-nas alayha. You know, la tabdila li khalqi Allah. There is no change in the creation of Allah. Everybody will have this fitra. You know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, dhalika ad-din al-qayyim. Your fitra is this true religion, true faith that you will always have. And then, but most people don't know, because most people change their own fitra, you know, in this case. So. Why people change their fitra, by the way? Because what is Satan? Do you remember what Satan, when Allah created Adam? What did Satan threaten, you know? He didn't actually, if you notice all of the verses in the Quran, Satan never threatened Adam. He threatened the descendants of Adam and said, I am going to make you deviate from the signs, you know, the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why people deviate that suddenly things which is completely against the fitrah, any, you know, then suddenly they make it good and they make laws to support it. How can this happen? Obviously, Satan is working. You know, I mean, he's not leaving the children of Adam alone. So the question is, would you fall? And this is why the revelation came, to ensure that, you know, this is your enemy. You know, how to ensure that you never follow his footsteps. Then Allah subhanahu also point to another in the surah, to another one of his signs, which is an economic sign. And this is, you know, unfortunately, we as a Muslim, as repeat again, when I talk about Muslim, I'm not talking about individual, I'm talking about the Muslim nation as a collectively, you know, all the 60 some Muslim countries that exist, that gathers all together to actually to support the people from Gaza. They wouldn't make a single rule, you know, 60 some nation cannot make a rule with 2 billion people to just forget about even supplying people from Gaza with arms. To just support supplying them with food and water. How this is really, can you think those people read the Quran? Is this is the Muslim that Allah wants us? It is the fitrah of the person, even the human being, all of this leader, that they leave another person dying in the cold. Look, the cold is outside, is a little bit cold now. What look of everybody dressed? Can you imagine people in Gaza living in the street, no clothing? I know a family from Gaza that actually their older people, their house was destroyed, and then they bid, this is a shameful part, they bid $40,000, the husband and the wife, so they can be allowed to leave Gaza to go to Egypt. And they came out from their houses with what? With just the slipper and the clothing they had. Who charged them $40,000? Do you think it is the Israelis? And we say, we are Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so give us this. He said, okay. In alam yaraw, alam awalam yaraw anna Allah yabsatu rizqin man yasha'a wa yaqdir, inna fi dhalik la'atin. Fa'ati dhal qurba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't they see that Allah expand the provision for some people and restrict it on others to demonstrate, yes, if a person in need and Allah give you something, you should be generous, you know, and he should be grateful to you. And that create the harmony between the society in this regard. And then Allah, they said, these are signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if Allah create everybody wealthy, all of us will be miserable. Why? Because nobody will work for anybody else. You can, nobody will come to collect your trash, nobody will come to your house, nobody will make, everybody's wealthy. Why he need to work? You know. So the creation of even the rich, some people rich and some people poor, is intended to make the society operate, you know, in that case. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Fati, if you are rich, if Allah give you money, Fati dal qurba haqqahu al miskina wa ibn sabil dhalika. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, then in that case, give haqqahu, his right. Because Allah trusted you with his money, give it to you, but his trust for you for his money. And Allah tell you, give it to him, give it to your near relatives who are poor, you know, give it to the needy, give it to the wayfarer. And Allah subhanahu, ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ لِلَّذِينَ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ. This is better for you if you're really seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, acceptance of you. And then وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, and these are the successful one. You know. Then Allah subhanahu says, give another economic. وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن رِبَى لِيَرْبُوا فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. وما أتيتم وما أتيتم من زكاة تريدون وجه الله فأولئك هم المضعفون. That, and if you use, if you earn money by usury in order to increase your money, then that will not increase with Allah. But if you give as a charity seeking Allah acceptance, Allah will multiply it manifold, and you will be the one, Allah will multiply it to you, you know, will manifold, ضعف, مضاعفة, you know, in that regard. So Allah subhanahu wa gave us this. Okay, if you keep seeking money by taking, you know, basically riba, then in that case, it's never going to be good with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you really want to increase your wealth, be charitable and support the people who are in need. And there is a promise. أولئك هم, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I multiply it to you. I probably said this story so many times, but it's probably worth reminding, you know, people didn't listen before. I was giving a talk one time in University of Oklahoma in Norman. So they asked me, you know, can you raise money? We want to fix the roof in the masjid. So, and I don't like to make fundraising because I feel people have to pay their money. You know, it's not an auction or you move them emotionally to pay. They should come out of their heart, you know. So I thought I'll give them a story. I told them, who listened to this story from me? Okay. There's some that didn't listen to it. But it's probably worse than him. Because frankly, I can do it and you too, and you will fail too. So let's do this. At this time, I took, my son was studying there. So I give him, I think, a $1,500 or something, you know, for his expenses when I went. So I told him, I said, look, you know, there is a company, and this is, you know, the technology is true, the company is false, okay? About the, when the oil companies produce oil, there is gas comes out of it. The gas is a problem because it's not large enough quantities that you can put a pipeline and send it, chill it, and then you cannot flare it. In the past, you used to flare it, you know, but now it's not allowed because environmental. So they have to drill another well and inject it. So some people was coming, I was a technology actually developed by the Germany called Fischer-Tropsch to take the gas and convert it to diesel. And therefore, they can convert it to liquid and bomb it with the oil. But the cost of it, if you do this, take the gas, become equivalent to like $400 a barrel. Obviously, it's a major expense too. So companies have been working to develop a technology how to reduce that cost, to bring the cost reasonable enough, you know, too. So I said, there is a company in Tulsa that I know the guy, and he have developed this technology, and he is going to basically open the company for investors. And if you guys are interested, and I'm sure, you know, as soon as this go public, you know, there is going to be doubled probably within a year, the price. If you have, the minimum is $1,000. If you want to invest, you just raise your hand. And after that, I'll take your name and tell you how much money you invest. Everybody sitting in the masjid raised their hand, including my son, you know. I mean, it's really amazing. Then I said, okay, here, Mamdouh Salama is telling you about an investment opportunity, and because you trust me, you trusted me. Now, Allah tell you he is going to increase it 700 times. With whom you are going to invest? Me? Do you trust me or you trust Allah? You know, I said, who is going now? Who raised his hand? He can do that. Every hand came down. I said, this is the problem. You said, yeah, we believe in Allah. We believe in the Quran. If Allah tell you something, you don't believe in it. Because in order to believe, you have to act. I mean, if I believe in something, I act upon it. Because there is a benefit will come out of it. But if somebody else tell you you believe in him, you act upon his obedience. So whom do you believe? This is really the problem with us as Muslims. We think we believe. And this is why it's all our, this life is a test because of this, you know. But I guarantee you this, you know, there's no reason to continue with this because I discussed this issue so many times. I guarantee you, if you are running in difficulty financially, you know, just to make a contribution, make a charity with a sincerity, you know. And then believe me, you will always, that money will come from avenues that you never know. And saved you from spending money in things that you probably would have spent. And there is many, you know, personal story, there's no reason to continue to it. But remember this. For, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about this science, you know, about the science, about the finance and so on. Why? Intended because you as a Muslim nation have to possess these things in order to be able to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you are uneducated, no matter how great your religion, nobody will listen to you. If you are poor, no one will listen to you. Therefore, you have to do it. You have to be the wealthy guy who owns the business and people working for him. So when they tell them about something, they actually make their own free will decision. But now you are the worker. Are you going to go to the CEO and tell him about Islam? If you are a student, are you going to tell the professor? Or if the professor comes in during the time of prayer and said, oh, sorry, you'll give me 5 minutes because there's a time of Zuhr, I'm going to pray. Wouldn't all of the non-Muslim students will think about it? Wait a minute, what is this religion? And be keen about it. And if they honor, respect the professor, they hopefully will try to follow and study what he has. But if you are a student and workers and poor guy, who cares, you know? And so,
Verse 37. Let's say the kurba has a haq.
Absolutely, yes.
And then whatever is left over goes to masakin.
Well, yes. If you have, it's like money of zakah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say haqq means it's obligatory upon you. And we know the obligatory things is zakah. So the question was related to the verse that say, you know, give your near kins, you know, their rights and the poor and so on. So in this regard, yes, if you have money of zakah, spend it in your near, your relatives first before you spend it outside. And you have this priority. A Muslim have to think about it. And spend it in the poor who are in this society more than the poor in another society, and so on. So everybody has, a Muslim has to always think about sitting, not everything equal, and Allah give us, because everybody have to look. Because frankly, if everyone supports his poor, there is always, in any poor family, there is always somebody rich. If he take care of them, there will be no need for somebody else to support them, and the money will go somewhere else. So. And this is why, regarding to this, is an interesting one. The Prophet ﷺ recognized this, recognized that when Muslims are poor, that actually does not help in delivering the message. So here is, there was a man by Kim Adi ibn Hatim. Adi ibn Hatim. Adi ibn Hatim was a king and very rich Arabian, a king, you know, rules one of the tribes. And his father was one of the most generous guy. So anyway, the Adi ibn Hatim came to visit the Prophet. So the Prophet told him, and Adi ibn Hatim at the time, he wasn't a Muslim. He didn't accept Islam yet. So look what the Prophet is telling him. He said, Adi, probably the reason that you are not entering in the religion, in Islam, is the poverty of the Muslims and that they have nothing. So the one of the reason why people enter when they see people poor. And then he continues, but by Allah, money is, let me see. Yeah, it will be in the verge or something, you know, the money will be on the verge of flooding them, you know. Yeah, فقراء لا يملك شيء ولا يشيكن المال أن yeah, the money will be on the verge of, I don't know why I didn't capture it. The money will be on the verge of flooding them that they will not find anyone who will take it. That wealth will come to, and it happened, it did happen. Muslim used to collect the zakah and they wouldn't need, didn't know whom to give it to you. To the point they said, we'll find people who don't marry and give them the money so they can get married, you know. And then he said also, you know, Uday, maybe the reason you are not entering the religion is the meager number and the large number of their enemy, the small number of the Muslim and the large number of them. By Allah, they will become so strong and their land so secure that Muslim women will travel alone from Al-Qadisiyah, which is Iraq, and visit the house in Mecca and fear nothing. Can somebody look from that statement to derive a rule? Yes. See, the issue is it why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said a woman cannot travel except with a mahram? Because security. So the verse here says it will come to the point that it becomes so secure, Muslim will become so strong, their land is so secure, that a woman can travel by herself from Iraq to this without afraid only from the wolf. You know, that's the another hadith. And then you continue. And, you know, so one, he said, okay, one is poverty and the other one is strength, you know. And he said, Uday, maybe the reason for you not entering the religion is what you see of power and the glory of others. By Allah, you have different empires now. By Allah, you will soon hear that the white palaces of Babel is the palaces of Kisra, have become under the control and the treasure of Kisra will be fallen in him. And this is the Prophet ﷺ saying it while he is in Medina. We're still Muslim, we're still poor, and then fighting, you know, against him. But he was saying, we will take over Persia, you know, at that time. And obviously Muslim took Persia before they take the Byzantine Empire, the Romans. So that tell you when you find, you know, people, and people sometimes say, oh, people enter into Islam and so on. But the point is, yes, people enter into Islam, but enter into Islam by their intellectual capacity, not because they admire the Muslim. You know, these are people who are seeking guidance and Allah supported. Anybody who seeks guidance to reach the truth about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will always guide him, you know. But if you want to get massive people to enter, you need the strength. And this is what early Muslims, why we all became Muslims anyway? Because Muslims, when they came, they wealthy people controlling the countries. And we all, that was the first one. Yeah. Then the surah actually, in addition to this, I said the physical, the sciences, and the history, and the human development, and so on. Allah hated that saying Muslims are not people who live in cocoon. Islam is a universal religion. And therefore, Muslims have to understand all of the international conflict that happened around them. You know, and therefore, the surah started actually with a case of a conflict that Muslims have nothing to do with it. You know, because at that time, Muslims were so weak in Medina, being attacked by the Arab from everywhere. And you have these two great empires, the Persian Empire and the Roman Empire. And they were fighting each other all the time and occupying every land. You know, every land was occupied either by the Persian or by the Roman. You know, Yemen was occupied by the Persian. Egypt was occupied by the Roman. They all fought against each other in the area of Sham, you know, of the Jerusalem and so on. This area was always a war between them in this regard. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a battle that occurred 6 years. And remember, this surah was revealed where? In Mecca. So before the Prophet immigrated. So that's, you know, so this is battle that 6 years before, you know, basically after the Prophet ﷺ became prophet, before he immigrated, this verse was revealed. And this verse revealed there was a war happening between the Persian and the Roman, and the Roman, and the, sorry, the Persian won. The Roman was Christians. The Persian were, you know, pagans. But the pagans won against the Muslim, against the Christian or the people who believe in, at least in God. And when the Persian took, they took over Jerusalem, took the Beit al-Maqdis, took that area. So the verse came and says, Alif Lam Mim, غلبت الروم. The Romans, the Romans were defeated. Remember, these people, Muslim, revealing a revelation in Mecca, talk about an international event happened to people that they had nothing to do with them. Okay. Then في أدنى الأرض, and in, you know, let me word the word أدنى. If you look to all the translation, you say in the nearest land, because land of Jerusalem was next to Arabia. But let's think about it a little. Hold this for a second. وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون. And after their defeat, they will win. That means the Roman lost the battle. Now Allah is saying, but after a while they will win. But Allah said not just say they will win, because you can leave it open-ended. But Allah subhanahu في بضع سنين. بضع سنين means in 3 to 9 years. بضع in Arabic, you know, word for numbers. If you said بضع number, it between 3 and 9. So Allah subhanahu says that the Roman will win between in 3 and 9 years from now, after they, you know, that lost that battle. And Allah subhanahu say, لله الأمر من قبل ومن بعد. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the decision belonging to Allah, the formal one and the later one. Their defeat was a decision of Allah, and their winning will be a decision or control of Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَيَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And on that day, the believer will be joyous. You know, why the word the believer should be joyous? Because the Roman will win. I mean, we are sitting here in Mecca, you know, in a difficult situation, being persecuted. Are we going to be happy, you know, from somebody, you know, wins outside? So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that day when the Roman will win, the believer will be joyful. بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ يَنْصُرُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. They will be rejoice with the victory of Allah. He gives the victory to whom He wills, and Allah is Almighty, most merciful. So, and then Allah emphasized this, وعد الله. This is a promise of Allah, and Allah will never fail His promise, but most people do not know. ولكن أكثر الناس لا, بس most people do not know. So when the revelation, obviously, we really think about it, when this one, Muslims are persecuted, they probably need a revelation to reinforce them and so on. So here Allah revealing about a battle that happened between the Roman and the Persian and tell them, you know, they are going to win. The Roman will win back again in 3 to 9 years. And, you know, how you will be, there will be joyful with the victory, you know, and Allah promised the victory. So the people of Mecca, obviously, when heard this revelation, they becoming, you know, basically, why they became so happy? First of all, they became so happy that the Persian won. Why? They said, you Muslim will never, look, you keep claiming these people of the book, oh, they were defeated by the big idol worshippers. So they were so happy with it. The interesting part is that 7 years from that time, the Muslim, the Roman has a battle with the Persian and the Persian won. The Roman won, sorry. The Roman won. The Roman won. 7 years, within the 3 to 9, after basically within year 7 from that war. But what is this? What happened in that day? Because the verse says that the believer will be joyful at that day. It, the same day the Roman won was the Battle of Badr. And obviously the Muslim was so joyful and joyed. And so the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, you know, that bi nasrillah, it wasn't referring. Allah said, okay, they will win, but in that day, you also will be victorious. And that's how the verse, you know, but this happened when? You know, it happened 7 years after. يعني the prophecy of it 7 years after, you know, that will happen. With the same day, the battle of the Roman one is the same day the battle of Badr. And that's why the Muslim, always the Roman, the Muslim at that time, you know, when they fighting battle of Badr, they care less about what happened in the Roman and the Persian, you know, but that is the coincidence that will happen in this case. The other word that I said, think about it a little bit, because that is when you read this verse. I mean, you can read this verse and skip it and go, you know, and read it 10 times. But if you come and say, let me stop and say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, غُلِبَتُ الرُّومُ فِي أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ. So why Allah have to describe أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ؟ ما غُلِبَتُ الرُّومُ هُمْ بَعْدَ غَلَبِهِمْ يَنْصُرُونَ. The أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ didn't add anything to me if you come and say it was nearer to the Arabia. Obviously, it's nearer to Arabia. You know, why Allah add this word? It must mean something, you know, as a Muslim who do think about it, they say, what doesn't, because there is no word in the Quran should be there if it's really a logical word that you can understand by yourself. You know, why Allah have to add it? But if you look to Adna, the word Adna, it turns out it means two things. Adna means it's nearer or lower. It's the nearest or the lowest. Then you said, okay, Arabs at this time thought about it, okay, Adna means nearer. So that's how they can understand it, they know lowest. But now when you look to where this battle happened, this battle happened in the near the Dead Sea. Where is the Dead Sea? The Dead Sea is 1,390 feet under the sea level, below the sea level. It is the lowest part of the land. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, they will gain victory on the lowest part of the land that you didn't know even lowest at that point. But people will come later and say, okay, here is the location of the battle. What is, how far deep it is? And it is the lowest part. So Adna, suddenly when you translated, you said it's not the nearest land, but it should be the lowest land. The proper translation actually should be the lowest land. Then the surah ends by directing us, you know, to study and ponder on the extensive science of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَقَدْ ضَرَبْنَا لِلنَّاسِ فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ مِنْ كُلِّ مَثَلٍ. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, that we have set forth for the mankind in this Quran all the kind of parables, all of the example and so on. Yet if you bring it to them any sign, you know, وَلَئِنْ جِئْتَهُمْ بِآيَةٍ, if you bring them any sign, this ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that exists, you know, لَا يَقُولَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفْرُوا إِنْ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا مُبْطُلُونَ. So the people, you know, the disbeliever will say, you are nothing but just making false claim. And then Allah said, in this way, Allah seals up the hearts of those who do not want to know. And this is something that is so important. You know, the worst position a human being in is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically say, that's enough for you. You have received enough information, your heart is sealed, you will never believe. You are distant to the hellfire. So those people who continuously reject, no matter how clear is the signs for them, that would be the end for them. There's nothing you can do about it. Therefore, don't to continue discussion with them. You know, Allah subhanahu كَذَلِكَ يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ لَعَنْ. Because when there is a sign, they just say, oh, you're just making it up. It's a false claim, you know. And then Allah subhanahu, what do you do in that case? فَاصْبِرْ. إِنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ وَلَا يَسْتَخِفَّنَّكَ الَّذِينَ يُوقِنُونَ. So be patient, Allah promised is the very truth, and do not let those who are devoid of certainty shake your firmness. Because sometimes, particularly kids, sometimes say, oh, I'm going to try to convince my friend and so on, teacher. But the trouble with it, instead of you teaching him, they drag you to the wrong. So if you find that people do not accept, leave them alone. Be patient and stay firm, you know, otherwise they might, you know, shake your own belief. I skipped one thing when I talk about the battle of the Roman and the Persian. So I said, in fact, actually, I asked the group yesterday, I said, if I know, you know, something, would, if I tell you, like, you know, I know tomorrow 100% sure that it's going to rain, and you tell me, oh, no, that's ridiculous. And I said, okay, well, we can make a bet, $10. If it rains for me and If it didn't rain, I'll give you $10. Would this be a gambling? I don't know who is here. I think all of the people around here, they said, no, it's not gambling. It's not gambling because, you know, yeah, I mean, there is a guy don't believe in you. Okay, well, put your money wherever your mouth is. So here is the case that happened. When this revelation came about the Roman will win, there is, you know, basically one of the, you know, kuffar, it came, Ubay ibn Khalaf, who was a very worst man, came to Abu Bakr and said, you guys kidding? The Persian is won, you know, and you're telling me the Roman will win again? There's no way to do it this way, you know. So Abu Bakr said, because the Quran was there saying they are going to win. So he said, I bet, yes, make a bet. He said, okay. And he said, they are going to win in 3 years. Because remember, I tell you, you know, but I mean, 3 to 9. So Abu Bakr said, okay, I'll make a bet that they are going to win in 3 years. He said, okay, we'll give it 10 camels. If they win in 3 years, you know, Ubay ibn Khalaf is going to give Abu Bakr 10 camels. And if they didn't win in 3 years, then Abu Bakr will give him 10 camels. But why, you know, Abu Bakr, since it's from 3 to 9, why in the world Abu Bakr will bet on 3 years only? Because in his belief, he said, Allah will not keep this, you know, prophecy delayed that long to prove these stupid guys who don't believe in the Quran, you know. So he bet the 3. So he went to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tell him, no, get tell him within 9 years, but increase it from 10 to 100 camels. So Abu Bakr went to Ubay ibn Khalaf and said, okay, well, it's not, if you say 3 years, 10, I'm going to tell you it's going to happen within, before 9 years. And will, can you bet 100 camels? So Abu Bakr said, yeah, 100 camels. They agree on 100 camels. So in this case, when Abu Bakr was immigrating, you know, Muslim was leaving to Medina, Ubay ibn Khalaf knew that Abu Bakr was going to leave too. So he came to tell him, wait a minute, how about our bet? You know, he said, what are you going to do? And he said, well, my son, his son Abdurrahman was still, you know, non-Muslim. He said, my son will fulfill the bet for you. So 7 years after the bet was made, you know, Abu Ubay ibn Khalaf was preparing to leave for the Battle of Badr. Then, you know, within in that case, Abdurrahman came to him and said, Ubay, wait a minute, if you leave and die, get killed, who is going to pay the 100 camel then? And he said, oh, my son will honor the bet. And then obviously, you know, as I said, when the battle happened and the Roman won, then, you know, Abdurrahman took the 100 camels from Ubay, you know, family, and took it to the Medina, to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Abu Bakr, you know, took the 100 camels, said, oh, Prophet, what am I going to do with it? He said, okay, just distribute it as a charity. So, and that, you know, so obviously you cannot say this is a gambling because one, I'm 100 sure that, you know, it's going to happen because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it's going to happen. So, what they say here? A wager, okay. Well, it's a bit, it's fine. Okay. You said, oh, wager? Well, wager, not wager. Yeah, you're right. Boy, you guys are good. I wish to send this to you guys to review it before I do it here. Okay. One thing which I just share, you know, for you, it's not part of this surah, but I told you there is 11 times when ayatihi came, and the other, so that means 7 came in this surah and 4 came in another surah. So these are the verses that comes in surah Fussilat came to twice, and in surah Shura came to twice, and all of them related to the signs of Allah in the universe in this regard. So you can read it in your own. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت فإنك يا ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم فضلك ورحمتك على كلمة الحق والدين، اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. Oh Allah, forgive our parents and all our friends and relatives who have passed away. Oh Allah, make their graves garden from heaven and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, we have many of our friends and relatives who are sick. Oh Allah, our son Ma'raj, our daughter Aishawani, and many other brothers who are sick. Oh Allah, grant all of them full and speed recovery. Oh Allah, guide our children, protect them, and make them righteous. Oh Allah, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't. And we seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. Oh Allah, we have many of our brethren who live under oppression and injustice. Oh Allah, we have many of our brethren who need your support. Oh Allah, show them a miracle. Oh Allah, grant them victory, heal their trauma, protect their helpless, and grant them lasting and peace and prosperity. Oh Allah, we ask you every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weakness have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين.